2003, I visited Assisi during a very difficult time, very sad time in my life. When we got there, something came alive inside me that I can't explain, but I knew that it was somehow linked to the person of St. Francis. And as a result of that moment, when the light broke in, I knew that being a writer, that there was a book in the offing. And for me now, all it involved was a matter of the execution of it. I knew if I was going to undertake a book about St. Francis of Assisi, I had in some way to embody the kind of life he upheld. So I sold my belongings and moved to Assisi. I wanted to get inside his skin. Francis felt that as human beings, we ought to follow the laws of the pilgrim, which he defined as someone who gathers under a strange roof to proceed peacefully and to thirst for our homeland. So that is what I tried to do. I also spent many hours in the primary Franciscan library in Assisi at the Sacro Convento at the Basilica of St. Francis, which is where he is buried. While I was there, I got to know the friars and sisters and had access to all the sources that I needed. What most people aren't aware of is that Francis was quite wild as a youth. He was the quintessential party animal. He was also very enamored with the Knights of the Round Table and the Arthurian legends, and even so, he himself aspired toward knighthood. As a result, he participated in two major wars as a young man. The first was a civil war during which the merchant class, of which Francis was a part, tore down the walls of La Rocca, which is Assisi's high fortress. This civil war eventually precipitated a second major battle in the valley between the town of Perugia, where the nobles from Assisi had been exiled, and Assisi itself. It ended up to be quite a devastation for Assisi, but Francis survived. Even so, he was captured. While he was in prison, he contracted malaria and tuberculosis. As a result, during his time of recovery, his heart started to change to the point where he finally recognized that there was nothing in this life that you can hang on to or aspire to that seemed to have any lasting value. He was beginning to sense that the only thing that mattered was to have a relationship with God and living the kind of life that Jesus described in the Gospels. There is a moment in his testament that he identifies as the moment, the final turning point in his conversion. In this particular moment, God brought into his path a leper. He understood that he couldn't turn away from this leper, so instead he dismounted from his horse, ran to him, and embraced him. And he says, after that, I lingered a little longer, and then I left the world. Once he was converted, certain members of the upper class first became bewildered and then curious, but ultimately they started to rally around him. He realized then that he had a movement on his hands, meaning he had to go and get permission from the church so that his little movement could exist without being deemed heretical. So at that point, there were 12 brothers, and they all went to Rome to see Pope Innocent III, who immediately rebuffed them. But Innocent had a dream during that time in which he saw a peasant come to his palace, which was crumbling around him. And this peasant came to the palace and shouldered it and lifted it up. He perceived in this dream this peasant was Francis. And as a result of the dream, the Pope took another audience with Francis and conferred upon him and his brothers the privilege to preach and to form an order. It was 800 years ago, this year, in 1209, that Francis and that ragtag group formed the Order of the Friars Minor. The most animating aspect as to why my book is different from any other biography to date about St. Francis is that I make some pretty bold statements about his relationship with St. Clare. I assert in my book that they loved each other before their conversion, but that in time they ultimately renounced their physical and romantic love in order that together they could embrace what they both deemed to be a higher kind of love. Love of following God in poverty and penance. Francis was a very simple man, but he put everything on the line for what he believed. And he took away from the rest of us the excuse that such a life can't be realized. He did realize it, and he did it with humility and joy. He accepted the suffering that attended his choices. He imposed upon himself the attitude of thankfulness to God despite the suffering. That's why my book is called Amended and a Broken Heart.